hurt. And if any of you have ever tried to implement doubly linked lists in Haskell, then you're familiar with the fact that it's a little bit different than doing it in a imperative language. But Brian's going to walk us through how you do that and benefits and anything else that he's interested in. So Brian Hurt, everyone.
Hello? Good. Yeah. Let's not go there. So this is implementing doubly linked lists in Haskell. This is a problem a lot of new programmers to Haskell run into, including me, so that's why I thought of this talk. So I thought I'd talk through how you actually solve this problem, because this is a little bit different in Haskell than in all the other languages. So I wanted, oops, if I turned this on. Wanted to start, the slides here, by the way, are up on my GitHub repo if people want to follow along at home. I will repeat this URL later, but it's just basically github/bhurt/presentations/dl-list. I wanted to start with sort of a refresher on what a doubly linked list is and why you would want one, for those of you who have slept through introductory algorithms and data structures. The idea of a doubly linked list is we have a bunch of items in a sequence-like container. Each item has an element associated with it, which has three pointers. One pointer to the item, one pointer to the previous element, and one pointer to the next element. The last element, of course, the pointer points to nothing, which is generally null or nil, and the first element, the previous pointer, points to nothing. And our overarching data structure holds the pointers to the first and last elements. So it's a very useful data structure, and you see it a lot in a lot of different programming languages, because it gives us a lot of capabilities that most other data structures don't have. The sequence-like data structure is very, very fast to get or remove or add elements to either end of the data structure. You just have to allocate an element and flop a couple of pointers around. It's very fast to concatenate two of these doubly linked lists together. And you can walk the whole sequence and muck with stuff in the middle to your heart's content. Add stuff, remove stuff, whatever you want to do. And it's all very, very fast to do this. So we want to use a doubly linked list, and we go to use it, and we discover there is no standard doubly linked list library in Haskell. Okay, this is odd, but it's an opportunity for us to write some code. So we dig in, and we start going, we're going to implement a doubly linked list library. How hard can it be? So we define a doubly linked list structure. It contains two pointers, the head and the tail. The pointers are mutable, so they have to be IO refs. They can be null if the list is empty, so that it's mapped into a maybe, and it's an element. Element, again, has three words, has a previous pointer, a next pointer, and a datum. Right? Works pretty much exactly how you would think. And you can start writing the functions, you know, make DL list, append, prepend, append to the end, prepend to the beginning, get the first, get the last, etc. Very quickly, you start discovering there are several problems with implementing stuff this way. The first problem is the memory utilization. For everyone else, every element is just a three-word data structure we have to allocate. So it's three words and some extra data, generally one, maybe two words, that's used by the runtime system to do garbage collection or whatever. This varies depending upon how much memory that per element varies depending upon what sort of runtime you have, but one word's about average. In the Haskell, we again have our three-word structure with its one word of overhead, except the IO refs are separate objects, and they have one word with overhead. And the maybes are separate objects, and they have one word with overhead. And so instead of just this very simple compact data structure, we have every element as this huge thing. We're using three times as much memory. There's an even bigger problem that you might have noticed in one of the earlier slides. all of our functions, because we're allocating and modifying I/O refs, have to be in the I/O monad. The old Haskell hands are going, stay out of the I/O monad to the fullest extent possible, stay pure, stay immutable, don't be in the I/O monad unless you absolutely have to. Well, now, to do anything with our doubly linked list, even allocating a doubly linked list, we have to be in the I/O monad for various reasons. So this percolates through our entire program. Now every time we're touching an I/O, a doubly linked list, we have to be in the I/O monad. Any module that might be touching code that's touching code, so on. It just, now everything's in the I/O monad. This leads to the question that would legitimately be asked at this point, is Haskell simply broken? That it cannot implement this basic data structure? Give you a free hint, the answer is no. So we need to back off here and think for a minute. What's the problem? Where did we go wrong? And where we went wrong was actually a fairly subtle but deep error. We confused the solution to our problem with the problem itself. So the very common thing for humans to do, especially programmers to do, we only have one solution. We don't even think of the solution as separate from the problem. We just go, we need that solution. If we have two solutions, now we can think about the problem in abstract. But if we only have one solution, if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So what is the problem we're trying to solve? What is, you know, let's back off, let's stop thinking about doubly linked lists for a minute. What is it we're actually trying to do? Well, dear Santa, I would like a pony and an Xbox and a data structure that does all of this stuff. I want it's a sequence-like thing. I want very fast add, get, and remove both the first and last elements. I want fast concatenation. I want to be able to slam two of these suckers together and make one big sucker. I want to be able to walk the sequence and add and remove stuff in the middle. And I'd also like it to be immutable and pure. And I'd like it to have reasonable memory utilization. While I'm drawing up my wish list, I might as well go for the whole hog. Well, if I can walk the list, I can find stuff in it. So what the API we want to implement here is we want some sort of doohickey. Don't know what it is. We want a doohickey here. We want it to have, we want to be able to create an empty one. Want to test, is it empty? Want to be able to append an element onto the end, prepend an element on the beginning, get the first, which returns a maybe. If the doohickey is empty, we return nothing. The doohickey has at least one element in it, we return the first element and the rest of the doohickey with that element removed. The nice thing about lazy evaluation is I can return you two pieces, and if you only want one piece, you throw the other piece away and you don't pay for it. So if you only want to remove the first element, you just call this and throw this element away. If you only want to get the first element, you call this and throw this guy away. And you don't pay for the overhead of computing the stuff you don't need. Lazy evaluation is a very neat thing, I may just say. And lastly, we want to do concatenation. We want to take two of these doohickeys and slam them together. This is the API we want to implement. This is the problem we're actually trying to solve. How do we implement this API in Haskell? I'll give you, yes? Yes. So the A here is literally any variable, any type A. So it can be doohickey, it can be a doohickey of A, it can be doohickey of some type that hasn't even been invented yet. Works for everything. A bit of terminology, what I've been calling a doohickey up until this point is actually called a deque or deque. There's some discussion over how to actually pronounce this word. I call it a deque. A deque is something you have a barbecue on where I come from, damn it. But you will hear a lot of people call it a deque. So I would like to welcome you to implementing deques in Haskell. My name's Brian Hurt. I'll be doing this presentation. But now that we know what we're doing, I want you to just go, here's the same API, I just want to make it a type class really quick, because we're going to have more than one of these. I'm going to give you not just one solution to this problem, but two solutions to this problem. And I will comment, there are a bunch more out in the literature. There's way more than two solutions. These are just the two most useful, in my opinion. So, solution number one, I don't know what the actual technical term for it, I should look it up, is just the two, what I call the two list solution. The idea here, we have our sequence of elements from starting at element zero, I'm a programmer, I always start at zero, through element n minus one, so we have n elements here. We're just going to break this sucker into two parts, a front piece and a back piece. And we're going to, what's interesting is we're going to take the back piece and we're going to store it in backwards order. So our front list will be element 0, 1, da 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 da, to k minus 2 to k minus 1. The back list, element n minus 1 will be the head. So we'll be coming in from the back and going backwards. So n minus 1 will be the head, and element k here will be the last element in the back list. That makes sense? So, defining this data structure is very simple. We just have a structure with two elements, front and back. So we can sit there and go, creating an empty, both lists are just empty. Very simple. If both lists are empty, then the whole thing is empty. If either list is not empty, then the whole queue is not, the whole deque is not empty. That makes sense? So if I want to prepend, the advantage of this is that both ends of the queue are close to the head of our normal singly linked Haskell lists. So if I want to say prepend an element to the beginning of the queue, I just take the front of the deque and slap it right on front with the standard Haskell cons operator. And of course, the back of the deque remains the same. If I want to append to the end, it's exactly the same trick, except now I'm just prepending it to the back queue. Remember, the back queue is backwards. It's in reverse order. So to make this the last element is the first element of the back deque. Right? To get the first, well, if both lists are empty, then we have to return nothing because there's no elements in the list. If the front list is not empty, then we can just take the first element off the front list, and that's the first element of the list. And so we can just return just the first element, and the rest of the list is the first element, the rest of the first list, and the unchanged back list. Now it is possible, because I'm doing no balancing here, remember, it is possible for there to be elements in the back half of the queue, but not the front half of the queue. So in that case, I just take the back half of the queue, do a reverse the whole list, and make that the front part of the queue. And then I can just, in here I'm being lazy, I just call get first on the resulting queue, which will immediately drop into this case and take the element off the first queue. Fairly simple, right? People are following? Get last works exactly the same way, except I'm taking stuff off the back half of the queue first. And again, if it is possible for there to be no elements on the back half of the queue, so in that case I have to reverse, yes, at that point I have to reverse the front part of the queue to turn it backwards. I thought I had a bug here, but I didn't. To concatenate two lists, I can just take the front list, the first one, I take the front of it, and I reverse the back of the queue to turn the whole thing into a single in-order list. Remember, the back queue is reverse again. And I can do exactly the same thing, except I'm doing it in the reverse order. To create, I take the second queue and to create the back. note I am, the back of the deque is the front of the list. This is a reversed list. This whole thing is a reverse of the list. That makes sense? Same trick, different slide. So you might have noticed something in an earlier slide. I skipped over actually walking through and adding and removing elements into the middle of the list. The reason I did that is because I can actually do that in a general way. Given the implementation of the deque I already have, just being able to add and remove elements to the beginning of the and end of the list and concatenate two elements together is sufficient for me to walk the list. And the trick I do exactly the same trick as the to list trick. I define myself an insert point is just a combination of two deques. I have a front deque of stuff that has already gone past and a back deque of stuff that is still in my future. I can turn any deque into an insert point. I'm calling it an insert point here. You can actually think of this exactly like a Java iterator. It's a pointer into the queue as to where I am in the queue. I can just make an insert point of any deque by simply going, the pair is the empty deque, nothing has gone past yet, I'm at the beginning of the queue, and the deque is everything that's in front of me. So again, we're playing sort of the same game with the two lists, except now we have two deques. I can do my standard Java iterator stunt. I can define has next. I have a next pointer if I have something in my future, i.e. if my future deque is not empty. I can get the next element, which returns, takes an insert point and returns maybe an element and the updated insert queue. I need to do a maybe here because there may be no elements in my future. I may have no elements left. So in that case, I return nothing. If I have at least one element left, I can call just get first on future. If I have at least one element left, that becomes my element. And note, as the element moves past, I append it onto the set of elements that have already gone past. So I've removed it from the deque on the future and added it to the deque on the past. Does this make sense? Still, this all makes sense in my head. I'm not sure if I'm making sense out there is my problem. Likewise, at any point in time, I can insert an element into the sequence of elements I'm walking through by just going, oh, add it to the end of the stuff that has already gone by. And I can also remove the element that has just went by. I can sit there and I can go, that element I just saw go by, remove it from the list by just removing it from the past element, past deque. You can do exactly, I'm not going to go through the code, but you can do exactly the same stuff to go, put this object into my future, make it so it's the next object I'm going to get, and remove the next object I was just going to get. And go step backwards as well. You can go both directions. It's just you move objects from one queue to the other. Does that make sense? And of course, at any point in time, I can sit down and I can go, I'm done modifying stuff. So I want to take my insert point and convert it back into a deque of elements. And that's just, I take the past and the future, and I concatenate them back together to make one big happy deque of what the result is. And I note, all of this is purely functional. I'm not in any IO monad here at all. This also, by the way, has pretty good memory utilization. I didn't mention that earlier, but about 3 words per element. Yes. Yes. Yeah, to the IO monad, the early slides, that was there. You needed to be in the IO monad to allocate, read, or update IO refs. And so all of the mutable references in the doubly linked list were IO refs, so you had to be in the IO monad. You could pull a stunt and make them ST refs and be in the STM monad. You run into other problems there, not to mention the fact that you end up in the IO monad fairly quickly anyways once you do an atomic leap. But so, yes, another question. Would you want to do some type of balancing? No, because I'm just about to get into that. The question is, do you want to do some balancing? The question is no, because you're using lists at the atomic level, so to speak, any sort of balancing you're doing is going to end up order n, and it's going to kill you anyways, which is exactly what this slide was pointing out. The problem was using two lists. The two-list solution. It's very nice, it has decent memory utilization, it's dirt simple to implement. If you need to just bang out a deque for whatever reason really, really quick, this guy works, the two-list solution works quite well. But there's a problem with it. A problem is with this code right here. Reverse is an order n function. If you give it a list of a million elements, it takes a million steps for it to reverse that whole list so you can get the first element off the list. So this actually can run you into real problems with using this code. It's not even rebalancing, which is a different problem. Say you have a queue, you add a million elements to the end of the queue. So now the front half of the queue is completely empty and the back half is a million elements. And you say, give me the first element of the queue. I now have to do a reverse of that million element list to reverse the whole list. If you then go, okay, the first element was interesting, so now I have 999,999 elements on my front list, give me the last element of the deque. Well, now I'm having to reverse the list all over again to go backwards. And you can actually run into what's called a replay problem, which is, since these are immutable data structures, I add a million elements to the end of that deque. I call that deque A. Remove the first element. That creates deque B, which takes a million steps to create deque B. But I can still access deque A. I can go back to A and remove that first element again. And to do that million step reverse all over again. This can kill your performance of your program real quick. So that's the downside with doing this. So another solution I want to talk to you about, which does not have these problems. The more complicated solution, it's a trickier solution, but it has very, very nice asymptotic behavior. It will not have you reversing a million element list all of the time.
Yeah.
Yes, so it was the worst case order n squared. Yes, you could literally, if you had it all on one side and you did remove the first, remove the last, remove the first, remove the last, you could literally do order n squared operations to do all of that. Most of the time it's order one, because if you add a million elements to the end and then you take a million elements off the front, well, the first element costs an order million to take off the front, but all the rest are order one because you're just removing the first element from the list. So it works, this works much better in places where you're doing consistent behavior, adding on one end and taking off the other. So I want to introduce to solution number two. Solution number two is called 2-3-4 finger trees. And this is going to be a little bit more tricky, a little bit more complicated. It's based on the paper Finger Trees, a Simple General Purpose Data Structure from Ralph Hines and Ross Patterson. Ralph Hines has done a lot of interesting data structure work. I just comment, he's an interesting guy to follow. Here is the URL. I will have that URL for you at the end of this, end of the presentation. So we start with your standard binary tree. Now you can implement deques with binary trees, and they work. The problem with having the binary trees is when we want to be adding and removing stuff at the beginning and the end of the sequence, so down here. So every time we want to get the first or last element of the tree, we have to come in, this is where our root is, we have to come in and walk all the way down the spine to get down here, which is where we really want to be. And so it's order log n, exactly. So if you have 8 elements in the queue, this isn't that big of a deal. If you have 100 million elements in the queue, this is a slightly bigger deal. It's not instant death, I comment, but it's not nearly as fast as having our old doubly linked lists were, which is just allocate an object and swap a couple of pointers around. So the idea is, why not, instead of coming in here, why not come in down here, down at the leaves, which is where we actually want to be? That instead of having one entry point into the data structure, we have two, which is at the bottoms, so we can find the beginning and the end much faster. We, of course, to get to the rest of the tree, we need to reverse the spines of the outermost spines. We need the pointers to go up instead of down. So instead of the pointer going from B to D, we need D to point to B. So this would allow us to, if we want to get to element 4 here, we would just have to come in here to G, go up to C, then down to F, and then down to 4 to get there. So this allows us, this regains, we can now get back to all of our elements in our list. So I'm going to take this data structure, I'm just going to grab it by D and G. I'm going to shake the sucker, right? I'm just going to swing it up. So D and G, instead of being down here at the bottom, I'm going to swing D and G up here into the middle and have the rest of the data structure fall down, right? And you end up with that. Now, this is exactly the same data structure as, you know, this is exactly, come on, exactly the same data structure as this guy. It's all the same nodes, all the same edges, and all the same direction. Wrong direction. I'm back here. It's just I have pulled D and G up to the top of the list. And the children have swung out. Children of D and G and B and C have swung out. And A has, what A used to be our root, has now fallen all the way down here to the bottom. This is starting to look, this is exactly the same graph, but just drawn a different way. Once you draw it this way, you start going, this looks a lot like a list. We could just merge these two elements and these two elements. We'd have a list right down the middle with the children hanging off to either side. Right? So we can just do that. This is just, all I've done here is I've now merged D and G into one node, one big common node, and B and C likewise. And now we have a very obvious sort of linked list, which is our combined outer spines of our original tree. This is the tricky part here. If you get this, everything else is easy and flows out of this. So, by all means, if you're confused, let me know. You're confused?
So, don't you always start at the root? How did you get where to DG?
Oh, I just declared way back here. Instead of here, we always start at the root. So that's your classic binary tree. I just said, rather than starting at the root, we're going to start down here simultaneously. We have two roots. I create the tree in this form. This isn't, I'm not converting a previous tree into this. I'm just sort of start from the idea of a tree and then convert it into this other form. because, okay, one of the things I didn't actually specify here, these are the actual items in the list. So these are our elements. So these may not, these may just be ints, they may be, these are some type tick A. And I've just numbered them here for convenience. So our elements that we actually have control of that's in our data structure are letters. The items are numbers. Yeah. That makes sense? So this is a finger tree. And one interesting thing to note, and I am skating over a little bit of a detail I will come back to at a later point, but notice at each level, the depths of the trees are the same. So BC, both of these have a height 2 tree. At DG, they have height 1. If it had been a 16 element tree and I had another layer down here, they would be a height 3 tree, each with 4 elements in them. And yeah, so each element, each step down this tree we go, the children that are hanging off of it become one level deeper, holding twice as many items, right? So we can define this as a data structure fairly easily. I have a finger tree A, is either an empty finger tree, a single, yes. We have an empty finger tree, a single element finger tree, because I don't want to deal with the weird behavior there, and a deep finger tree, which has a list of head children off the left, a link to the next deeper finger tree, but note it's a finger tree of node A, not of A, and a list of children to the left, list of children to the right, and our red link down. So these guys are the first list, these guys are the second list, and this is the red link down. First list, second list, red link down. And note, we're using Haskell's type system, by the way, to enforce the fact that every level has a greater depth than the level before it. So the top level finger tree A is going to be, these are going to be of type A. The first step down we do, these are going to be, the A's are going to be node A's, which are going, is just a pair. The next step down from that will be nodes of nodes A, which will be pairs of pairs, etc. So we're using Haskell's type system to actually enforce an invariant here. So, circling back, you may have noticed one of the things I didn't do here, that I didn't provide any way to balance the tree. I just assumed, of course, the tree is balanced. Of course, you always have an absolute even power of 2 in your trees. That's not always true. So I'm going to talk about how to balance the tree in this circumstance that maintains the invariance we want to maintain. So the idea is to use, instead of normal binary trees, to use 2-3-4 trees. And the idea of a 2-3-4 tree is it's just like your standard binary tree, except elements can have, instead of just 2 nodes, like normal, they can have 3 nodes or even 4 nodes as 4 children. Right? So if I want to add a child to a particular node, if it's a 2 node, I can just turn it into a 3 node, free. If it's a 3 node, I can just turn it into a 4 node. If it's a 4 node, what do I do? At that point, I have to split it into 2 children. I split it into a 2 node and a 3 node. And I add this new node that I just created up in my parent. So I start my splitting. When I'm adding a node on a 2-3-4 tree, I always start the splitting at the very bottom. And I keep splitting all the way up. I can, you know, if it's 4 nodes all the way up, I can just keep splitting all the way up. And if you get all the way to the root node, and you have to split the root node, that's a point where you add a whole new level to the tree. You add a two node at the top of the tree. So you're always adding, when you add a level to the tree, you're always adding it to the top of the tree, which automatically pushes everything in the tree down an equal amount. So there's always the same number of nodes between your root of the tree and any child. It's just a question of, are there two nodes, three nodes, or four nodes? That make sense? You have a question?
The only thing I'm unclear about is the rationale for adding three nodes.
Well, what do you do with the extra node? So you have a four node, and you add... Oh, you don't move it up. These stay at the same. These stay at the same level. So this becomes.
They end up having to split.
Yes. So in this case, when you're adding a child and you have to split the child, you're adding a child. You add a child to the parent, which may in turn cause it to split all the way up. That makes sense? Have a question? The traditional tree. In this case, I'm talking about the traditional tree. So it's the root, I mean a traditional root. Yes. Yes, there is. There is, in fact, there is a 2-3 version of this. You can, in fact, generalize this to be any A or B, at least A and at most B children, and that works as a data structure. And the name for this, it was originally called an A-B tree, but they started dropping the A off, and they started just calling it a B tree. And so you may hear the database people talking about B trees as an index form. This is exactly what they're talking about. And just in this case, the A is 2 and the B is 4. But you could go A is 16 and B is 64. Works just fine. Same logic applies. Yes. Yeah. So, well, I mean, they balance by, they do balance by splitting the nodes. So that is how you balance. There is, and by the way, if somebody wants to hit me up at the bar afterwards, there's an interesting relationship between 2-3-4 trees and red-black trees. But I'm not going to go into it now, so. Because it's utterly not relevant. So instead of having a node 2 of just being an AA, I did something weird in this slide and didn't explain it. My apologies. I am keeping the node 2 as just a pair. Because when I split the 2 and the 3, I'm going to keep the 3 local and only move the 2 up. So that will make sense in a moment. Don't worry about not understanding that. So we have a node A is still just a pair. We've replaced the list of A with what I call a digit, because there can only be 3 cases here. And I don't want to deal with, on my pattern matching, I like exhaustiveness checking, and I don't want to have to deal with cases that can't happen. So now we have a slightly different approach. We have 3 different possibilities. One child, 2 child, or 3 children. It is possible. And you can think of this as, and this is actually the correct way to think about this. This is your 2-3-4 node with one child missing. And the child missing is the rest of the tree, basically. It is the deeper tree. Not what I wanted. That will make more sense in a minute. Give me, sorry about that. So this is our new data structure. If I want to prepend an element to my my finger tree, if the finger tree is empty, it just becomes a singleton. The finger tree definition is empty, single, or deep. It remains the same. If it's a single element, then I convert it into a deep element, with the first element on the left-hand side, the second element on the right-hand side, and the deeper link is just empty. This make sense? Well, the tricky part, and this is where hopefully things will start making sense, is, where am I? Yeah, the tricky part is where things will hopefully start making sense is what happens when it's a deep. If it's a deep with a with only one child on the front, then I can just make it a two child. This is the equivalent of going from a two node to a three node. And I can go from a three node to a four node equivalently. But if I have the three children, which is the equivalent of a four node, I need to split it. Yes, I still only have four children here. So this becomes technically a three node, which is two children plus everything below me. And I create a node of the remaining two children and recursively add it to. So this is the splitting of the node points. This is where I have to split two nodes split one node into two nodes. Does this make sense? To get the first element, I'm not going to go through all of the code here, by the way. I'm just going to do the basics so you get the flavor of this. To get the first node, if it's empty, there is no element, so it returns nothing. If it's a single element, you just return the element and the queue is now empty. If it's a deep and it has at least two or three children, then we can always just remove a child. We can just remove a child, and that becomes the default case. The tricky part is, what happens when we don't have enough children? So if there's only one child on our current level, we're going to return it as our node, but we need to bring another child up from the deeper list. So we're going to recurse it down, so we return x and reduce q. If we have a first element of the deep, so there are three possibilities. There are the left children, which there's only one left child. There's the deeper queue, and then there's the right children. So if the deeper queue is not empty, we can remove a child from that, and we will actually get back a node. We will actually get back two children, because the deeper tree is always pairs of elements. So when we get back two elements, that just becomes the left children. The deeper tree has no elements, it's an empty tree, so we're sort of at the bottom of the list here, then we need to take elements off of the right-hand list of elements. And again, if we have at least two or three elements, so we can just remove one for free, we can just suck the element off and go, okay, that's our new left-hand element. That's the rebalancing you were talking about earlier. If there isn't one, then we reduce back to the single case. There is only one element. We were in the case where we had one element on the left, one element on the right, nothing in the deeper queue. The element on the right simply becomes the last remaining element. Yes? Yes. Yes. Yes, and one of your children is everything that was already up the tree, up the list. So, yeah, so the question is, why are the nodes always one less? And the answer is, if you go here, so like let's take a look at BC here. He only has one child here, right? He has the E child here, but here, if we go back to here, we note that the B not only has the E child, but he also has the D child and the stuff under him. Does that make sense? So when we came here, the B child, the two children of the B children, are the E guy here, and everybody up here, the D guy up here, is his other child. So everything previous to you in the list is the missing child. Does that make sense? Trying not to baffle you with the bullshit. I have enough dexterity. Where are we? Oh, easier implementation of this, by the way. Import data sequence. There is a standard library. It actually does implement 2-3 trees, not 2-3-4 trees. I didn't realize that till after I had presented the whole slide, and then it was like, wait, it's only 2-3 trees. Oh, well. So this is how you implement that the correct way. It's a very rich library, has a lot of operations on it, everything you ever want. It's a functor, it's a traversable, it's everything. Yes? Yes. So the question is, what are the average and worst time complexity of your operations? The average time for everything except the average time for concatenation and the worst case time for concatenation is order log n. The average time for everything else amortized is order 1. Because most of the time, remember, most of the time, if I want to do a get first, if I have enough children, I don't need to go any deeper. So 2 times out of 3, I only need to look at the, you know, if you hand me, sorry, if you hand me this finger tree, 2 times out of 3, I don't need to go past DG to get you the first element. 4 times out of 9, I go to BC and stop. 8 times out of 27, I go to the next one. You do the math, and it works out to be average about 1. I forget exactly what it is, but it's order 1, amortized. And worst case, and obviously, the worst case is I have to go all the way down here and work all my way back up. So it's worst case order log n.
So I imagine that those boxes carry over these trees.
Yeah. On the complexity actually goes over. It's order log the number of log base the number of average number of children you have. So if you did this with 8 16 trees, it'd be log base 12, which means you'd very rarely go farther than 1. But you have an increased code complexity there. So the question was, if you did AB trees, how would the complexity carry over, the complexity constraints carry over? And the answer is yes. But you get more complicated code. Which is actually what I was about to go into. You can do a larger slots. You can just simply sit there and go, I'm going to do 3 children instead of 2. Now your memory utilization here was the node 2 was just using pairs here. If you have 1 million elements in your queue, almost all of the elements, the should have duplicated the slide a lot, because almost all of your elements are going to be in tree elements. If you have 1 million elements in the queue, they're almost all going to be in various tree elements here. The overhead of the spine here is going to be minimal. It's going to be 1 million elements in this queue, you're going to have 20 spine elements, and that's going to be nothing. So if you do pairs, you're going to need, on average, 1 pair for every node. Because it's going to be, you know, your first level is going to be, you know, indiv 2, the plus indiv 4 for the level above that, plus indiv 8, adds up to 1. So you're going to have 1 of these for every element. So this guy is going to be about 3 words of memory for every element in your queue. But if you did triplets instead of double, and had allowed more children. So now you can have, this is a 2-3-4-5 tree here, technically, or a 2-5 tree, so you can have up to five children, technically five children here was the missing child. Now, you're only going to have one of these for every two items in your queue. So you're going to have 1/3 for the first level, plus 1/9 plus 1/27 plus etc. You're only going to have one of these for every two items in your queue on average. That's going to be where you use all your memory. This is a 4-word data structure. So if I'm only doing one of these for every two items in the queue, I'm only using 2 words per item in the queue. And I'm actually doing even better now in terms of memory utilization than the standard doubly linked list implementation. Right? So, now what we have, the sequence-like thing, we have very fast add, get, remove of the first elements. We have fast concatenation. I didn't cover concatenation. It's pretty obvious once you think about you're just combining two trees. Though the code should be fairly obvious, assuming you're not just using data sequence. You can walk the sequence and add and remove items in the middle to your heart's content. And it is immutable and pure, and actually has pretty good memory utilization. So we're not getting the pony or the Xbox, but we at least got our data structure. I want to leave you with one final thought before signing off. It's been said by me and a number of other people, it's not original to me, that learning Haskell makes you a better programmer, even if you don't end up programming in Haskell. There are 1,000 reasons why this is true. One of them is what I've just explained to you. When you go back tomorrow to programming your Java or JavaScript or whatever it is you program on your day job, if it's Haskell, I envy you. But most likely it's not. 99.9% of the time, when you want to use a deque, you want to use a doubly linked list. If you're in a mutable language, why not? But every once in a while, you may not want to use a doubly linked list. And so now, I've given you the knowledge and the ability to go that one time, to go, here, I don't want to use a doubly linked list. I want to use a two-list solution or a finger tree solution and have a better solution. We've all become somewhat better programmers thanks to Haskell. That's it. Here's the paper and the slides and the library, which is the important part. Have some questions? Yes. It's simpler to bang out. So if I know that, if I know how I'm going to use it isn't going to trip over the bad parts, and I just want to bang out something, and I need it to be immutable, so I don't want to use a doubly linked list, the two-list solution works nicely. You also see it in a lot of other circumstances. So, for example, if you're like editing a file, if you're writing a file editor, you could sit there and go, my state of the file is a deque, except I reverse it. So I have all of the, I just have, it's sort of like my insert point, except I just use lists for the insert points. And you can do stunts like that. So it's easier one to bang out, is the answer. Question. Yes? The items would either be in one or the other, but not both. You never have them in both. So if you had the lists 1, 2, 3 as your front list and 3, 2, 1 as your back list, the whole queue would be 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Does that make sense? Does that help explain the doubly linked list? Okay.
If I could add It's not on. Oh, there it is. Oh, okay, I just wanted to add a couple brief points because you asked what you named the two-list structure. That's named a banker's queue. In the literature, if for people that want to look that up, because they use the banker's method to prove its asymptotics, I'm surprised. The second point is your insert point trick. In the literature is what people refer to as a zipper. So if people want to read about generalizations of that, you're going to recognize that as one version of a zipper structure.
Yes.
And I think I had one other point, if I can remember it really quick, in terms of just where to look in the literature to name things. When you have a structure where you have a node and then you have a node of nodes and right, and each time sort of the branching changes and that's in the types, in the literature those are referred to as non-regular recursive types. So there's a whole body of literature on that. Thanks for the great explanation of finger trees. It was one of the clearest I've seen.
Okay, thank you. And one of the nice things about giving these talks is I always learn something from Gershom that he corrects me afterwards. Any more questions? Yes. Okay. The question is, am I using the IO refs because it's cyclic? No, I'm using the IO refs because they're mutable. I want to be able to change them after the fact. And when I add an element to the head of the queue, I want to go what was the element, the previous head of the element, its previous pointer now points to me. It used to point to null, or nothing in this case, but now I want it to point to just me. And so you that's what I was using the IO refs there was for mutability. I also mentioned, I do want to mention the problem if you use ST refs and use the STM, the software transactional memory references and the software transactions. Software transactions do not like it if you update millions of nodes in a single transaction. They're not happy at you. And so you run into some serious performance problems, and I wouldn't be surprised if you found bugs there. So I don't recommend using. Yeah. So you will run into problems. It will be heartache and pain and tears and recrimination. So, any other questions? Yes. The problem isn't the mutual recursion. The problem is it's a mutable data structure. And I need to be able to come back at a later point and go, this pointer has changed, without reallocating the whole data structure every time I add or remove an element. If you try to do a pure doubly linked list without an IO ref or something similar to it, you can do it. But you end up reallocating the whole data structure every time you do anything to the data structure. Because if you reallocate element one, that means element two needs to be reallocated because it's pointing to element one, which now means element three needs to be reallocated because it's pointing to element two. So you sort of need to break that to be able to go, I need to change this element without allocating a new element. That makes
all right,
sense.
Guys. We're going to have to cut it off there to make sure we have enough time for our next speaker.
Yep.
As Brian mentioned before, he'll be joining us at the bar afterwards, so you can hit him up with any additional questions you have there. We're going to take about a 5 to 10 minute break, and then we're going to get going on the next talk.